نستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. واشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، واشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My dear sisters, those of you who know me know that I usually don't plan too much ahead for what it is I'm going to talk about. I usually choose my topic, or my topic hinges on the kind of conversations that I've been having with my sisters in the community, maybe a couple of weeks or a couple of months before the event. So my talk today is for the sisters who are going through a lot of trouble at home, for the sisters who, subhanAllah, their husbands abandoned them and their children and left them destitute. This is for my sisters who are stuck in a very bad situation at home. And subhanAllah, they're really struggling. They're really struggling to leave. And inshallah, Allah will give them the strength to do what they need to do for themselves and for their children. And we have to make dua for them, bi-idhnillah, that Allah helps them out of their situations. This is for my sisters who are under the impression that God only afflicts and tests sisters who are not right on their deen. This is the kind of conversations that have been coming back to me. A sister hears about an affliction that has befallen her sister. Maybe, subhanAllah, the sister's daughter had a child out of wedlock. And what does she say? Well, maybe, subhanAllah, she would have been better in her deen. She would have been covered more. Then this wouldn't have happened. She must be a very bad person for Allah to test her like that, to afflict her like that. SubhanAllah, what has she done for Allah to be so angry at her like that? This is for my sister who is under the impression that she did do something wrong, that there's something inherently wrong with her. And this is why Allah is testing her. And this is the kind of conversation that comes, oh my God, Allah is angry with me, Allah is angry. What did I do? What did I do? So inshallah, I hope that with this talk, that we're able to frame affliction, that we are able to frame ibtila, and not look down at others that whom Allah has afflicted, and be there for them and support them, right? And to look at ibtila in a new light. In a new life, that it's not, subhanAllah, might be better for you. So, whenever I say anything in Arabic, be it an ayat, verses from the Quran, or hadith, I will translate into English. I will be referring to the word ibtila a lot. Ibtila means tests, trials, tribulations, afflictions, hardships. The history of affliction is what I'm going to address today, inshallah, and that's the title, Back to the Future. I do not know how much Michael J. Fox is going to appreciate my play on the title, but too bad for him. But in order to understand where we are, we have to look back. Right? In order to make sense of what's happening and start planning for the future. And the future will also look back to us. There isn't a human on the face of this earth, be it Muslim or non-Muslim, that is not afflicted in some way, that is not tested in some way. One person might be tested with good, because good is a test too. And another person might be afflicted or tested with bad. كما قال الله تعالى في سورة الأنبياء, verse number 35, وَلَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّرِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةً. Allah says, and we test you with evil and with good as a trial. As good is an affliction and a test, and bad is an affliction and a test. And oftentimes, my sister's affliction with good is harder than affliction with bad. Because when someone is tested with good things, in a lot of cases, this good preoccupies you. And it makes you forget. It makes you forget your obligations to Allah, and our obligations to your sisters, and to your communities, and to yourself. You're in this euphoric state of being that everything's good. Everything's going my way, so we're not really thinking. And it makes, subhanAllah, some people when they're, and I say they're afflicted with good, because good is also a test, that it makes some people transgress against others. When Allah blesses them with blessing, they use that as a means to transgress against others. إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمَ رَبِّي, except those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mercy upon. But when someone is tested with bad and with hardships, a lot of times you can kind of muster up that strength. You're aware, so, okay, something's missing, something's wrong. And I need Allah, I need the people. So there's a sense that you're in a different state of consciousness than when everything is going your way. And you can a lot of times lay back on your faith, lay back on patience, or ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant you something and patience. Provided that this person believes in qadr, believes in predestination, because Allah said, "Wa al-qadr khayruhu wa sharruhu." Destiny or predestination, be it bad, you have to believe, or good, you have to accept it. Bad and bad is also ibtila. Ibtila has a very long history that is as old as creation. For the second, the story of humankind began on this earth, and trials and tribulations have become intertwined in an inseparable companionship with us from the minute Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them. And I don't want my afflicted or my tested brothers or sisters to be under the delusion that they are living all sorts and colors of hardships that is exclusive to them. It might be exclusive to their circumstances, yeah, everybody has their own identity, but if you look and ask, you see this repeated again and again, it's not exclusive to you. Hardship is not exclusive to you. Affliction has a long history, and you might be taken aback for those who think that only bad people are tested. Ooh, ew. What is she doing that her kid is smoking weed around the corner? This is the things we hear. What is she doing that her husband's acting up like that and making a fool of him? She must be an awful person. And you might be taken aback to know that the most afflicted of all people were the prophets, the Anbiya. It was narrated in Sahih al-Tirmidhi, and the isnad is Sahih, it sounds, from Abi Sa'id ibn Abi Waqas. He said, radiallahu anhu, that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qala, حين سئل يا رسول الله أي الناس أشد بلاء. So Sa'id ibn Waqas said that Prophet Muhammad alayhi wa sallam was asked, oh Prophet of Allah, who are the most people that are most tested? Prophet Muhammad says, الأنبياء ثم الأمثل فالأمثل. So, look at how Prophet Muhammad answered. Look at how he answered. Prophet Muhammad didn't answer the Sahaba and say, well, it's the polytheists that are most afflicted. He didn't say the sinners are those who are most afflicted, right? Or those lacking in what they're supposed to be doing. No, he said that the prophets, then the righteous people, then those who are nearest to those righteous people in perfection. And Prophet Muhammad continues and says, and a human is tested according to his or her piety, the strength of her faith. And Allah increases his test, right, according to the level of his faith. If he is weak in religion, if she or he are weak in religion, then his test is reduced. Allah knows his state, so he said, I can't test this person like that. His faith, his piety is weak. But subhanAllah, if a believer's faith, as according to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is very high, he increases, Allah increases the test until Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, a believer will be tested until he walks on the earth without sin. So my sisters, allow me to go back and do check-ins with the different varieties of ibtila that the best of creation had under the prophets and the messengers alayhim salam, the kind of test that they were testing. The first messenger of the world is the ulama say, his fathers say, that the first Nabi, the first prophet was Adam. But the first messenger was Anas radiallahu anhu, narrated the hadith on the authority of Anas, that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أول نبي أرسل نوح. And you can find this in the Dayla Garawah al-Daylami, and Imam al-Albani did the tasheeh of this hadith. And another hadith, the first prophet sent with a message is Nuh. And another hadith, Ya Nuh, anta awwal ar-rusul ila al-ard. Nuh, you are the first messenger on earth, and this is a hadith. Yeah. Nuh, subhanAllah, was tested with his people. He was tested with the house of the Christians, and the first one he was tested in his people. Nuh alayhi salam was amongst his people for 950 years. 1,000 years minus 50. Nuh had not left a stone unturned in trying to find a way to reach his people's hearts, to get them to listen. And this is nasiha, some advice to my sisters working in the public field. And when you see people not listening, and when you see when you're out there trying to do something, the first thing they do is character assassination of you, to discredit you, to find reasons why they shouldn't be listening to you. SubhanAllah, I want you to take inspiration from you. 950 years amongst these people. And SubhanAllah, we'll see what the result. So I'm addressing those, my sisters, who are working in the public field and who toss and turn at night with their hearts torn and aching over the painful reality of their communities. They can't sleep. I say to them, this is Nuh, who sought out every means he could to call people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we have from in Surah Nuh. If you look at ayahs verses 5 to 13, I'll read them to you. I'll read them in Arabic and I'll translate in English. And look at Nuh's story. Look at what happened. قَالَ رَبِّ إِنِّي دَعَوْتُ قَوْمِي لَيْلًا وَنَهَارًا فَلَمْ يَزِدْهِمْ دُعَائِي إِلَّا فِرَارًا وَإِنِّي كُلَّمَا دَعَوْتَهُمْ لِتَغْفِرَ لَهُمْ جَعَلُوا أَصَابِعَهُمْ فِي آذَانِهِمْ وَاسْتَغْشَوْا ثِيَابِهِمْ وأصروا واستكبروا استكبارا ثم إني دعوتهم جهارا ثم إني أعلنت لهم وأسررت لهم إسرارا فقلت استغفروا ربكم إنه كان غفارا يرسل السماء عليكم مدرارا ويمددكم بأموال وبنين ويجعل لكم جنات ويجعل لكم أنهارا ما لكم لا ترجون لله وقارا. So Nuh is saying, my Lord, indeed I invited my people to truth, night and day. But the only thing my invitation did was have them flee even faster from me. No one's listening. And indeed, every time I invited them, Allah, so that you might forgive them, they put their fingers in their ears and covered themselves with their garments and persisted and were arrogantly arrogant. Then I invited them publicly. Then I confided to them secretly and said to them, ask your Lord for forgiveness. Indeed, He is the perpetual forgiver,
He will send rain from the sky upon you in continuing showers, and he will increase you in your wealth and children, and provide for you gardens and for you rivers. And Noah says to them, what is the matter with you? What is the matter with you that you do not attribute to Allah His due grandeur? So even after 950 years, the result was what? That only a few believed. And not only that, subhanAllah, if you look at his affliction, it's not only they didn't believe, but on the day of judgment, his people will deny that he did anything. His people will deny him. And this is according to a hadith in Sahih Bukhari that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to us. The fact is that on the day of judgment, yud'a Nuh. Nuh will be called. Allah will call upon Nuh on the day of judgment. And he'll be asked, Ya Nuh, hal ballaghta qawma? Did you not warn the people? Did you not convey the message to the people? And Nuh says, Naam ya Rabb. Yes, I did. Listen carefully. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls Nuh's people. He's like, come here. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to them, هَلْ بَلَّغُكُمْ Nuh? Did Nuh really convey the message to you? فَيَقُولُ قَوْمُ نُوح لَا مَا بَلَّغَنَا وَمَا آتَانَا مِنْ نَظِيرٍ. No, he did not, Allah. He did not tell us anything. He did not warn us, nor did he convey any messages to us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and he knows, Allah's asking all this, of course, and Allah knows. He asked Nuh, مَنْ يَشْهَدْ لَكَ يَا نُوح إِنَّكَ بَلَّغْتَ قَوْمَكَ. So Allah asks Nuh, who's going to testify for you? Who's going to bear witness that you actually did this? And Nuh says, يَشْهَدُ لِي مُحَمَّدْ وَأُمَّتِهِ. He says, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his ummah will bear witness that I did my job. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, and you will be called, فَتَدْعُونَ فَتَشْهَدُونَ لَهُ بِالْبَلَاغِ ثُمَّ أُدْعَى وَأَشْفَ أَشْهَدْ عَلَيْكُمْ. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then you're going to be called and you're going to confirm and you're going to bear witness that this is what Nuh did. And then Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will come and confirm what we confirmed. And this is where the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةٌ وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ وَيَكُونَ الرَّسُولُ عَلَيْكُمْ شَهِيدًا. In Surah Al-Baqarah 143, the ayah, and we have made you, wasata means a just, we have made you into a just community so that you will bear witness over the people and the messenger will be a witness over you. So subhanAllah, my sisters will get upset when sisters stab them in the back, when everybody is calling you out and looking for reasons why they shouldn't be listening to you, to undermine your message and your work, and the sisters stand there silently. Subhanallah, not only don't they defend, right? They actually attack or stand silently while they are trying to serve the community. Then Nuh, does this end, subhanAllah, for Sayyidina Nuh? No. Nuh is tested even more, alayhi salam. And he is tested with such a painful and hard test. He is afflicted in his son. He is tested in the fruit of his heart, the apple of his eye, by God. You know, subhanahu wa ta'ala, for those of you who know the story of Sayyidina Nuh's son, sometimes, you know, if a son died, if his son had died, it might have been easier on Nuh than what happened. Because ultimately what is the ultimate reality of us as human beings? That we all die, right? And not only that, as the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that, إِذَا مَاتَ وَلَدَ الْعَبْدِ قَالَ اللَّهُ لِلْمَلَائِكَةُ هَلْ قَبَضْتُمْ وَلَدَ عَبْدِي. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that when a child dies, he asks the malaika, the angels, he says, have you taken that child, that my servant's child's soul? And the malaika says, na'am, yes we have. And Allah asks the malaika, so when you did that, and Allah asks him, هَلْ قَبَضْتُمْ ثَمَرَةَ فُؤَادِهِ. Allah reaffirms that. Did you take the fruit of his heart? And the angels say, Na'am. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, SubhanAllah, he says, what did my servant say? ماذا قال عبدي? When you did that. And the malaika answers, حَمِدِكَ وَاسْتَرْجَعْ. He says, Alhamdulillah, وَإِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. We are to Allah, we belong to Allah, and to Him is our return. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the malaika, ابْنُوا لِعَبْدِ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ سَمُّوهُ بَيْتَ الْحَمْدِ. Build for my servant a mansion in paradise and name it the house of praise. And so, sisters, if Nuh's son had just died without this whole story of disbelief that happened, it would have been easier on him as a parent. Because all of us will ultimately die, as in Surah Al-Rahman, كُلَّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانْ وَيَبْقَ وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ. Right? Everyone in the Surah Al-Rahman, verses 26 to 27, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, everyone upon this earth will perish, and the face of your Lord will remain owner of majesty and of honor. So he would have gotten that closure of knowing he's going to be meeting him in the hereafter. But subhanAllah, to my sisters who have lost their children, to my sisters who, subhanAllah, have not only lost babies, but children that are 10, 11. And it's one of the hardest tests that a mother can go through. Look at what happens. Look. So Nuh is tested with such a hard test that I think that many hearts wouldn't be able to endure. A test that even if you were a strong mountain, a mountain of sabr, you wouldn't be able to bear. Nuh, that honorable prophet, the great prophet, is tested in his son, a great, great test. And what is it? His son disbelieves in God. His son disbelieves in Allah Azza wa Jal. Nuh's son disbelieves, subhanAllah. In Surah Hud, verse number 42, Nuh is telling his son, Ya Bunayya, irkab ma'ana, la takun ma'al kafirin. قال his son said, قال سآوي إلى جبل يعصمني من الماء قال لا عاصم اليوم من أمر لا إلا من رحم. So Nuh is saying to his son, my son, come aboard with us and don't be with the disbelievers. The son said, I will take refuge on a mountain to protect me from the water. Nuh says to his son, there is no protector from the decree of Allah except whom He gives mercy. SubhanAllah, look at what happens. Look at, so a parent's heart, like, even when you see your kid in that situation, or when you see, you can take this and apply it to people you love, who are in state of disbelief, your heart still, you're still gonna ask Allah. Look at what Nuh does, look at what Nuh does. So Nuh, overcome with emotion, parental emotion, he makes a plea to Allah. He says, in ayah number 45 in the same chapter, he says, Rabbi, inna ibni min ahli, wa inna wa'adaka al-haq, wa anta ahkam al-hakimin. Suppose, my Lord, indeed this is my son. He's not my family. And indeed your promise is true. And you are the just of judges. And what does Allah answer? Allah answers, he says, Ya Nuh, innahu laysa min ahlik, innahu amalun ghayru salih, fala tas'alanna ma laysa laka bihi ilm, inni a'idhuka an takuna min al-jahilin. So Allah says, O Nuh, indeed he is not of your family. Indeed he is a person whose work was other than righteous. So do not ask me for that about which you have no knowledge. Indeed I advise you lest you join the ignorant. And again, this is advice to myself and to my sisters who have people in their, or they're in situations, and we talked about this severing ties of kinship. When it's a bad situation and you know you need to get out, that look, this is a son. And what did God say? There is some situations where that cut has to happen. So Nuh says, Nuh عليه السلام says, قال ربي إني أعوذ بك أن أسألك ما ليس لي به علم ولا تغفر لي وترحمني أكون من الخاسرين. So Nuh says, My Lord, Subhanallah, look at the adab of Nuh. My Lord, I seek refuge in you from asking that of which I have no knowledge. From that which I have no knowledge, and unless you forgive me and have mercy on me, I will be among the losers. Let every mother and father that is tested in their child know that hidayat al-tawfiq, there's different kinds of guidance. There's hidayat al-irshad al-dalala, and I'll tell you what that means, and there's hidayat al-tawfiq. Hidayat al-tawfiq is a kind of guidance that is guided by Allah. You have no hand in it. The guidance that you can provide, though, as a parent, is called hidayat al-dalala wal-irshad, meaning do your job as a parent to not say, oh, God is, it's in Allah's hand, I shouldn't say anything. If God wants to guide my kid, he's going to guide my kid. No. It's your wajib to do what you need to do as a parent, but know that the hidayah of tawfiq, that guided hidayah, that guided guidance, is not in the hand of a sheikh that you like force on your kids, right? It's not in the hands of a sheikh. Alhamdulillah, they want to sit with you, fine. But know ultimately, it's not in the hands of messengers, as Allah said to Nuh, he's a messenger. Right, but it's in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even my own guidance, as Rima, is not in my own hands. So how can you bestow guidance on anybody else, to your child or anybody else? For the matter, what is in your hand is you giving advice and direction to your children, but the other kind of guidance that is in Allah's hand, neither I or you are in control of. And as Allah says in Surah Al-Qasas, verse number 56, he says this to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says to him, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. O Muhammad, you do not guide whom you like, but God guides whom He wills. So this noble Prophet alayhi salam is tested in his people. He is tested in his message. Look at these trials. SubhanAllah, we're afflicted with one little thing and we boo-hoo non-end. And for the sisters who think only bad people are afflicted and look down at their sisters that are afflicted, look at this Nabi, how many afflictions he's gone through. His wife also chooses disbelief. Right? So he's afflicted in his wife. SubhanAllah. I'm trying to summarize everything because if I'm honest, if we were to go back into the future, into glimpses of different prophets' afflictions, it would need a session by itself for each prophet. So forgive me, I'm trying to skim fast. So again, back into the future we go, and to the friend of Allah, Ibrahim. The friend of Allah, Ibrahim, Imam, the Imam of all the monotheists. A role model to all the prophets. Everybody can relate to Ibrahim, being a Jewish, Christian, or Muslim. He whom Allah has praised and ennobled. And regardless of all this, Ibrahim alayhi salam was tested in his father and in his son and in himself. Look at the variety of ibtila and affliction that Ibrahim alayhi salam had endured. He was afflicted in himself, and all of you know the story of how they lit a fire under Ibrahim alayhi salam. A fire that was so vicious, my sisters. And this is an actual fire, I'm not talking about a metaphorical fire. And some of my sisters are in the sisters have lit in a metaphorical fire. The community has lit in a metaphorical fire around some of these women that are trying to serve. As I said, character assassination. So the fire, you can take it metaphorically or as an actual fire. So Sayyidina Ibrahim, they lit a fire around him. The flames, according to, if you look back in the books, the flames, they say, were so high that the birds started dropping dead. SubhanAllah. And I asked myself, SubhanAllah, like, were they trying to burn the whole earth or just one man? But I think the fire that they lit around Sayyidina Ibrahim, the viciousness of that fire was equal to the viciousness of the animosity in their hearts that was directed to the symbol of monotheism. This Ramz al-Tawheed, Ramz al-Tawheed, symbol of monotheism, Ibrahim. And Allah saves Ibrahim, as Allah says in Surah Al-Anbiya in verse number 69. He says, قُلْ مَنْ عَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمِ. Allah says, O fire, be coolness and safety upon Ibrahim. And then Ibrahim alayhi salam is afflicted in his father. SubhanAllah, imagine for us who maybe whose members of family are on the same deen, or they're not doing what they're supposed to do, or they're just people you love aren't on the same page. And you're very upset, and you fight with them, and you argue with them, and you try to push wherever it is you're at them. Look at what happened with Ibrahim, and this is, as I said, Ramz al-Tawheed, the symbol of monotheism. His father used to carve the idols that of idols out of stone with his own hands and sell them to people to worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is Ibrahim's dad. Subhanallah. And Ibrahim, look at the adab. And Ibrahim, regardless of this, still talks to his father with love and adab. He talks to him with love and adab. And his father, unaffected, says what? Ibrahim tries to advise his dad with love and adab. And his dad says to him, look at what he says. In Surah Al-Maryam, verse number 46, he says, قَالَ أَرَاغِبٌ أَنْتَ عَنْ آلِهَتِي يَا إِبْرَاهِيمِ لَإِنْ لَمْ تَنْتَهِي لَأَرْجِمَنَّكَ وَهْجُرْنِي مَلِيًّا. So Ibrahim's dad tells him, have you no desire for my gods, O Abraham? If you do not desist, I will surely stone you. So avoid me as long as you can. For my sisters who maybe, you know, somebody makes a comment on the hijab, their parent. I mean, look at what Ibrahim's dad said to him. I mean, we blow everything up out of proportion. We don't have the endurance to listen to people and hear them out and accept where they're at. Accept where they're at. Is anybody telling you, I'm going to stone you? Is your mom telling you, I'm going to stone you? Or I'm going to, I don't want to see you and tell you, well, maybe that. I don't want to see you forever again, but subhanAllah, sabr, you know, sabr. Then Ibrahim alayhi salam is tested also in his son, right? The flower of his heart. قَالَ تَعَالَى in Surah As-Safat, ayah 102, he says, فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعْهُ السَّعِي فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعْهُ السَّعِي قَالَ يَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ إِنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى قَالَ يَا أَبَتِي إِفْعَلْ مَا تُؤْمَرْ فَتَجِدْنِي إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مِنَ الصَّابِرِينَ. So Ibrahim in this verse, and Allah says, look at, and I will comment on the choice of words, فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعْهُ السَّعِي, right? And when he reached, Allah says, when he reached the age of puberty, he's talking about Ismail. So Ibrahim says, oh my son, indeed I have seen in a dream that I must sacrifice you. So see what you think. What do you think of this? And he said, this is Ismail, says, my father, do as you are commanded. You will find me, if Allah wills, of the steadfast. And you know what, my beloved sisters? I think that this test that Ibrahim had to endure is a very unique test. It was never repeated again in history, where a father is asked to sacrifice his son, slaughter his son. It was very unique to Ibrahim. And if you contemplate a bit over the nature of this test, your mind isn't, as a human, you're going to reject it. How am I going to, like, God tells me I need to solve my book, right? A father is tested in his boy that he loves, right? A father is tested in his boy that he loves. And subhanAllah, like, you know, it's easier sometimes if our children, like, for example, if a father is sending his child off to the army, to serve the country. It's painful, you know there's a danger, but there's solace and you know he's serving. Again, if a father is afflicted in his son in sickness, that the son is sick, that, you know, he makes dua and he's suffering. But subhanAllah, imagine this kind of test, right? You have to sacrifice, a righteous man is asked to sacrifice his righteous boy, whom his heart has clinged to. whom he has developed a bond with. And this is when Allah says, فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعْهُ السَّعِيَ, meaning that the boy wasn't still a baby. Fathers develop bonds with their sons later than mothers do. So that age when Allah chose to, for that Ibrahim alayhi salam takes the life of Ismail, it was at an age when a dad in our modern times would be saying to his son, hey, let's go shoot some hoops. Come Ismail, let's do this. Come Ismail, let's do that. Ismail, give me this. He's gotten used to him in such a way, you understand? It's different. And at that point, when Ismail had reached that point, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks him to take his life. But, you know, there's a deeper meaning to this. There's a different dimension. If you can frame this deeper in such a way that you can say that he is ordered to kill and sacrifice any attachment that is in his heart to other than Allah. That's what it really what it was. The things we attach ourselves to in our hearts, and we put all those things before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. SubhanAllah, I'm told I have 3 minutes. SubhanAllah. Okay. I'm gonna have to skim, and you know what, my sisters, inshallah, I promise you, even though I have to drop some of the prophets, Allah forgive me, any friend, this is su adab that I'm gonna have to do this. Let me wrap up with Ayyub alayhi salam. Because there is no way, if I am on the topic of ibtida, afflictions, that I cannot talk about Ayyub alayhi salam. Prophet Ayyub was a mountain of fortitude, of patience. Sayyidina Ayyub alayhi salam was ill for 18 years, as mentioned in a hadith that Nabiullah Ayyub in Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ نَبِيُّ اللَّهِ أَيُّوبُ لَبِثَ فِي بَلَاءُ 18 سَنَةً فَرَفَضَهُ الْقَرِيبُ وَالْبَعِيدُ. So what does this mean? That Ayyub was ill for 18 years and was rejected. People, no one wanted to have anything to do with him. Those close to him and those that didn't know him. He was abandoned. And the hadith says, and by the way, this is hadith in Ibn al-Mundhir, and you can find it in the book of Imam al-Haythami. And the hadith, just to be honest, is qabil al-tahsin. It's open to perfecting. I just have to say that. So he was rejected by everybody except two men of his friends. إِلَّا رَجُلَيْن مِنْ خَوَاسْ إِخْوَانِ كَانَ يَبْدُوَانَ عَلَيْهِ وَيْرُوحَانِ. That they used to, these two men, like, were there for him. They visit him and show their faces. So one man said to the other, وَقَالَ إِحْدَاهُمَا لِلْآخَرِ لَقَدْ أَذْنَبَ أَيُّوبَ ذَنْبًا مَا أَذْنَبُهُ أَحَدًا مِنَ الْعَالَمِينَ. So one friend said to the other, he said, you know what, Ayyub committed some deep sins that no one else, what Ayyub has done, probably no one else has done. So the friend says to him, what is it? Why are you saying that? So the friend says, مُنْدُ ثَمَانِيَةَ عَشَرَ سَنَةً لَمْ يَرْحَمُهُ اللَّهِ فَيَكْشِفْ مَبِي. You see, he says, he's been sick for 18 years and Allah has shown him no mercy. So he must have committed shenanigans. Okay? The scholars of tafsir, commenting on this hadith, commenting on this, said that when Ayyub alayhi salam heard them say this, and he never asked Allah for anything, when he heard his two friends say this, he pleaded to Allah not out of fear for himself, but out of fear that his brother is going to be held accountable by Allah, يُؤْثَمْ عَلَى مَا قَالَ, that his brother is going to be held accountable for what he said about him, because he's Allah. So he pleaded to his Lord with this dua that is so loving and tender, and he said, في سورة الأنبياء, look at how he talks. And this is a man who was bedridden for 18 years, right? When I cut my finger, I can't stop boo-hooing. My back hurts, oh my God. A headache, oh, I'm gonna die, I can't take it. Look at Ayyub, even after 18 years, look at how he talks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says to him, وَأَيُّوبَ إِذْ نَادَ رَبَّهُ إِنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الضُّرُّ. مَسَّنِيَ الضُّرُّ وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ. He says that Job, when he called to his Lord, indeed, adversity has touched me, Allah, has touched me. And you are the most merciful of merciful. I just want to stop a minute and look at Ayub's choice of words. Adversity has touched me. He didn't say, oh Allah, adversity has broken me. It shattered me, Allah. I can't take it anymore. Adversity has taken hold of my spine and shaken me to the core, Allah. No one wants to have anything to do with it. Allah, that's it. I can't take it. And I hear this. I can't take it. I can't take it. People come, even myself, when I complain, subhanAllah. And look at his edit. He's like, Masani al-Dur. Adversity has touched me, Allah. And because he asked like that, look at the answer that comes in the same chapter, verse 84. Look at the answer, Allah says, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ فَكَشَفْنَا مَا بِهِ مِنْ ضُرٍ وَآتَيْنَاهُ وَأَهْلُهُ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ رَحْمَةٌ مِنْ عِنْدِنَا وَذِكْرَ لِلْعَابِدِينَ. Allah says, so we responded to him and removed what afflicted him of adversity, and we gave him back his family and the like thereof, with them as a mercy from us and a reminder for the worshippers. Ayub alayhi salam was tested in his money. He lost all of it. Ayub was tested in his sons. All of his sons died, by the way. Ayub alayhi salam was tested physically. As I said, his illness made him bedridden for 18 years. He lost his wealth, his health. He was patient. His patience, subhanAllah, is a thing to marvel at. SubhanAllah, look at what the other blessings Allah gave him. I'll just mention this, I'm not gonna go into the other stuff, but Allah saved Ayyub, not only physically, but he restored his wealth. رَوَى الْبُخَارِيُّ وَمُسْلِمْ مِنْ حَدِيثِ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ إِنَّ الرَّسُولَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ قَالْ أَمْطَرَ اللَّهُ عَلَى أَيُّوب جَرَادٌ مِنْ دَهْرٍ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala falling from the skies on Ayyub. Imagine when you're standing and the whole land is covered with golden locust made of gold. Can you picture this? SubhanAllah, and the ulama say that Ayyub was standing there and filling his pockets up and filling his clothes up until there was nowhere to put stuff. And he kept on filling his pockets. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Ayyub, he says, Ayyub, haven't you had enough? And Ayyub says, who can ever have enough of your mercy, my Lord? How can I be satiated from your mercy? Who can ever have enough? SubhanAllah. SubhanAllah. How are we on time? Am I out of time? The problem is because there's a very important thing I wanted to address, which is, I don't think I'm gonna... Okay, hang on. I think... Okay, just very, very quickly, very quickly. And I just have to say this because one of my smart aleck students posed this question. And he said, why all this ibtida? What's the wisdom behind all this? Doesn't Allah know anyway what it is we're going to do? Allah ya'lam ma kana wa ma sayakun wa ma... Why? Allah knows. I mean, people say we're tested so Allah can distinguish those who have faith from those who do not have faith. So this student, mashallah alayhi, he says, well, doesn't Allah know that anyways? So this is the part that I wanted to address, and in Surah Al-Ankabut, verses number 3, 1-3, Alif, Lam, Mim, Allah says, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسِ أَنْ يُتْرَكُوا أَنْ يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ فَلِيَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهَ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَلِيَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَذِبِينَ. Allah says, do the people think? Do the people really think that they will be left to say, we believe, and they will not be tested? Allah says, we have certainly tested and tried those before them, and Allah will surely make evident those who are truthful, and He will surely make evident the liars. So when I was just explaining, when I had said these two verses, that Allah is going to make evident the liars from the believers, this is when the student asked the questions. But doesn't he already know? I was like, Rima, he knows. So subhanAllah, just quickly, there is no way I'm going to be able to get to the, with the rest, but bi-idhnillah, I promise you I will have the rest of it on YouTube for you. I'll film it and I'll put it up on YouTube, okay? So just very quickly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yes, He knows. Allah, from sabiq ilmihi, Allah, because Allah knows everything. Allah knows the past, present, and future, right? But from His rahmah and from His adl, from Allah's adl, He's just. Allah does not want to punish you بصابق علمه بما ستفعلون. Allah does not want to punish you with the knowledge, based on the knowledge He knows of you. Based on, well, I know that sister XYZ is going to do this, so I'm just going to throw her in hell. Or I'm just going to do this. No. Allah wants you, out of your own free will, to act. Second thing, subhanAllah, when Allah tests you, like if He does not test you, I mean, this is something for you, maybe you don't know where the level of your faith is. Maybe you thought you had it all together. Oh, I'm good. My iman is mashallah until the ibtida falls. Because it's easy to be believers when things go our ways. Yeah, when things are good, it's easy to be believers. We're all believers when things go good. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yakshif laka nafsak. Allah reveals yourself to yourself. And Allah reveals Allah also reveals the hypocrites that are walking on the path to you that might be a hindrance. Maybe subhanAllah, you were in a companionship and you were amongst people that were actually hurting you. And you did not know. So the ibtila falls and everybody forsakes you, and you know who's the loyal from the unloyal. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the patience of our ibtila and to heal all our hearts. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.